In this video, we are going to discuss about building bylaws. So what is the importance of building bylaws and what is meant by building bylaws? So that we are going to discuss in this video. Firstly, what is building bylaws? If you see, during planning and construction of any building, certain regulations, there are some regulations that are laid by the government authorities, municipal bodies or authorities. Government authorities are insisting some regulations on the building construction owners. So in order to maintain a uniformity, okay. So other government departments as town planning, so as to prevent haphazard development of city, means uneven growth of city or uneven development of the city, irrelevant constructions or uneven constructions. In order to control this haphazard development or uneven growth of buildings, some guidelines were laid by this town planning or municipal authorities or government authorities or town planning authorities are going to insist some regulations. So such rules and regulations are called building bylaws. So in order to maintain a regular development of towns and development of towns and cities. So this is the first purpose for building bylaws, and that is what we call that regulations what were laid by that local authorities or municipal authorities or government authorities, those regulations are called building bylaws. Okay, so coming to the objectives of building bylaws. Objectives of building bylaws, if you see, the building bylaws allow discipline and systematic growth of buildings and towns and prevent haphazard development. First of all, the main objective is to control the haphazard development of the town or a city or a village, whatever it may be. In order to control the town and to prevent haphazard growth of development, systematic growth of buildings, in order to lay a systematic growth, not to maintain a uniform growth of buildings, systematic growth of buildings. And also another important thing is building bylaws protect the safety of public against fire, noise, health and structural failure. So another important advantage we are having with this building bylaws is mainly building bylaws protect the safety of public against fire and noise, health and structural failure. So mainly because of the public, in order to protect the public, if you are obeying this building bylaws, the building bylaws are constructed in such a way that they provide safety to the nearby public if any accident or if any hazard has taken place, then also the impact will be less on the surrounding people. So that is another advantage we are having. Next, they provide proper utilization of space and maximum efficiency in planning. So because of this building bylaws, proper utilization of space is going to take in place, so maximum efficiency is going to be achieved in the planning. Another thing, they provide health, safety and comfort to the people living in the building. Why? Because how it is going to provide health, if you see, because you are going to provide a good space for a good ventilation is going to be compelled, and good lighting is going to be compelled along with this building bylaws. So because of this good lighting and good ventilation facility, good air circulation facility, air circulation facility also will be there. So in order, because of all these advantages, definitely health of the occupant will be improving. Why? Because if you have provided proper opening spaces, proper side open spaces and proper rear open spaces, good light will be there in the building. Similarly, good wind flow will be there into the building, so that air circulation will be proper. So that leads to good health of the occupants. Next one, comfort of the people living in the building along with not only with the health safety, there is another important advantage we are having is safety. Why? Because if the buildings were laid obeying this building bylaws, proper spacing will be there. So because of that proper spacing, definitely if any accidents, fire accidents, or if any similar kind of accidents has taken place because of this spacing, that can that growth of that accident, growth of that fire or something else can be prevented here with the help of this spacing or with the help of the bylaws adopted that construction. So these are the objectives. Next, different building bylaws. So what are the different types of building bylaws, or what are the different building bylaws, in which areas these bylaws are proposed? So firstly, building frontage. So the front spaces, that is frontage. So it is the main margin to be left beyond the extreme edge of the road to the front of the building. So from road, if this is the road and if this is the building, so what is the space that is to be provided? So how much amount of space we have to provide, that is what we call building frontage. So if this is the structure and if this is the road and this is the structure, so what is this space we are going to provide, that is what we call building frontage. So mainly it depends upon the status of the area, nature of the road. So this building frontage is depending upon the aerial location, where it is located. If it is located close to a town, if it is in a rural area, it may be different. Similarly, nature of the road, what kind of road is available there and what is the width of the road available there. So based on that also, this building frontage is going to get modified. Next one, residential buildings require a minimum clearance, public buildings require more clearance. So that also you have to see, residential buildings require minimum clearance whereas public buildings require more clearance. So the space that is to be provided, or the opening, front open space we have to provide for residential building will be less when compared to a public building. Next one, and the purpose of this frontage is to facilitate widening of the road in the future. So the major purpose of this frontage is to provide for, to provide frontage means according to frontage of the building. So here we have already discussed about frontage. So here if you see in the tabular form, what is the plot size and what is the frontage required. So if it is a individual building, if it is a detached building with a square meters, area of that plot is more than 250 square meters, then the frontage required is 12 meters. Next, if it is a semi-detached building, if it is a semi-detached building means if it is a portions like building, or if it is like a grouped house, combined house, okay, semi-detached, two portions or three portions will be there combined together in a single building, then and if the plot size is 125 to 250 meter square, then the frontage required is 8 to 12 feet. And the row type building, if it is a row type building, a group building with a plot size, a minimum plot size 50 to 125 square meters, then 4.5 meters to 8 meters is the minimum frontage required. So here 12 meters is the maximum frontage. It is the maximum value required, and this is the minimum value required, 4.5 to 8 meters. This is for 50 to 125 square meters area for smaller plots. If the plot is smaller and if it is a narrow type building, then we'll be using 4.5 meters to 8 meters of frontage. And if it is a individual detached building with plot size more than 250 square meters, then we'll be going for 12 meters maximum footage frontage. So this is about frontage. Next one, coming to open spaces. So open spaces are essential. What is the purpose of open space means? It is to satisfy the lighting and ventilation requirement. So for every building what we are constructing as an engineer, good lighting facility is required. Good lighting facility is very much essential. Good lighting is compulsory. So the outer open space and the inner open space, what you are providing, that is very much important here. So let us see what is this outer open space. Outer open space, if you see, it is the additional margin to be left, within the plot to isolate the building from the road and neighboring buildings. Means, for example, if this is the plot, so inside you have to provide some opening spaces. So this is the area you are going to construct. Shaded area is the area you are going to construct. Means this is the plot, actual plot. But you are not going to construct completely in the plot area. We are going to provide some open space. So outer open space is the additional margin to be left within the plot to isolate the building. So this is the outer open space. This is the outer open space. Next one, inner open space. Inner open space means the open space within the building that are needed in heavily congested areas to provide lighting to the interior rooms. Means in some cases, if the building is closed or if it is closed on all the sides with surrounding buildings, then what we'll do, in within the building we'll be providing some opening space inside. So this is the inside opening space. Here shaded region is the inside open space. This is the building area. Building area is this, and this is the inside open space. Mainly you can see this type of inside opening when closely spaced buildings are there. If the buildings are closely spaced each other, side by side, if the buildings were constructed, then inside opening space is provided in order to facilitate lighting properly. Okay, they are needed in heavily congested areas to provide lighting to the interior rooms and create interior courtyard. Interior courtyard or open space will be created because of this inner open space, whereas outer open space is within the plot lefting some space so that proper air circulation and proper lighting facility and ventilation will be provided to the inner room, so that in order to facilitate good lighting and good ventilation, we are going to provide this open spaces. So this is about open spaces. So exterior open space, in detail if you see what is this exterior open space and interior open space, how much we have to provide. If you see, exterior open space may be in front, rear and sides of the building. So if this is the plot and if this is the building, this is the building area, shaded region is the building area what you are going to propose. So this is the front open space. This is the front open space, and this is the side open space, and this is the rear open space. So back one is the rear one, front if road facing is the front open space, and these two right and left are the side open spaces. So front open space, for every building fronting a street shall have a front open space. If there is a road at the front, then we have to provide this front open space. So what were the standards? If you see, if the width of the street is 7.5 meters or less than 7.5 meters, the minimum front open space is 1.5 meter we have to provide. Similarly, if it is in between 7.5 to 18 meters, if the road width is 7.5 to 18 meters, the front open space is 3 meters. And if the front open space is 18 to 30, here it was wrongly printed, 18 to 30, if it is in between 18 to 30 meters, then 18 to 30, if it is in between 18 to 30, then the open space is 4.5 meters. If it is more than 30, then it is 6 meters. So these are the open spaces that is to be provided at the front. So this is the front open space. So this is the front open space, okay? Open space. Front open space. So here you have to provide 1.5 minimum, and if the facing front road, the width of the street is 30 meters, then it should be 6 meters. Next one, rear open space. So coming to rear open space, every residential building shall have a rear open space of 3 meters, and in no case it should be less than 1.8 meters. So maximum is 3 meters and minimum is 1.8 meters. So for every building, the rear open space should be, so if this is the front open space and this is the road, here is the rear open space. So this space is to be at least 1.8 meters. 1.8 meters we have to provide at least a rear open space. Then coming to the side open space, so this is the side open space. So if you see that side open space, detached building should be having a minimum of 3 meter side open space at both the sides, whereas semi-detached building will have 3 meters on one side. So at least 3 meters we have to provide on this side. So if you provide 3 meters, definitely there will be good lighting facility and definitely there will be good ventilation facility in that room. So the open spaces mentioned are for residential building up to a height of 10 meters only. So all these measurements or all these specifications what we are speaking, or minimum requirements what we are speaking, are limited to buildings with a height 10 meters only. Next, coming to minimum standard dimensions of building elements. So what are the minimum dimensions we have to provide for the building dimensions? What are the minimum standard dimensions we have to adopt? At least it should not be less than this minimum standard dimensions. Whatever dimensions you are adopting, whether it may be plot area or whether it may be room area, whatever it may be, it should not be more than this minimum standard dimensions. So first one, area requirement. Limitations of area is achieved by satisfying the floor space ratio or floor area ratio. So floor space ratio, we will see FSR is equal to total covered area of all floors by the plot area. Total area covered area of all the floors by the plot area. So plot area may be different and the inside construction area may be different, floor area may be different. So that is why floor area divided by plot area gives you floor space ratio. So it ranges from 1 to 2. It may be in between 1 to 2 it will be. Next one, height of the building. So coming to height of the building, the height of the building is related to floor area ratio and provision of open spaces. So the maximum height of the building should not be exceeding 2 times the width of the road plus front open space. So for example, if the width of the road is 3.5 meters and front open space to be provided is 1.5 meter, means total 4-5 meters is the height, right? So the maximum height of the building should not exceed more than, it should not be more than 2 times, right? So 10 meters, it should not be more than 10 meters. Okay, so like that we have to calculate and we have to limit the building height also. So next, coming to minimum size of the rooms. So what are the rooms we are having? We'll be having bedrooms, living rooms, drawing rooms, dining rooms, study rooms, habitat room, kitchen, bathroom, storage room, garage, staircase. So all these are the components what were there, or the rooms what were involved in the residential building, right? So if you see the minimum area required and minimum size of the sides and minimum heights, minimum dimensions what we call. So for all these types of rooms, living room or bedroom or drawing room, it is 9.5 or 10 meter square is the minimum area. Next, size of the room side will be minimum of 2.4 meter, not more than not less than 2.4, means 8 feet nearly. It should not be more than 8 feet. It should not be more than 8 feet. Next one, minimum height, if we see, it should not be more than 2.75. It should not be less than 2.75 meters, means mostly 3 meters people adopt, or 2.75 is the minimum height of the room. Next, kitchen. Coming to the kitchen, the minimum area is 5 meter square and minimum width is minimum size of the room is size one side of the room is 1.8 meters you have to provide. So and it should not be less than 2.75 meter. Height should not be less here also. Why? Because so now coming to water closet or bathrooms, the bathroom area minimum area required is 1.8 meter square and the minimum size of the sides is 1.2 meters and height should not be less than 2 meters. 2 meters means around 6 feet. It should not be less than 6 feet. At least 6 feet height we have to provide. This is about a bathroom. Next, a storeroom. Coming to the storeroom, the minimum area required is 3 meters square and height should not be less than 2.2 meters. Next, coming to the garage. Garage area is 12.5 meters square is required and it should not, height should not be less than 2.2 meters. Next, coming to the staircase, the minimum width of the stair is 1 meter minimum width required and the minimum clear headroom shall be 2.2 meters we have to provide. The minimum headroom provided for the stairs is 2.2 meters. We should not provide more than that so that we will not get steep stairs. Okay, so that is why minimum height we have to provide so that it will be more comfortable. Next one, size of the rooms. So coming to the size of the rooms, drawing room should be very first room or we call it as a hall. So the area, minimum area required is 10 square meter or 15 to 20 square meter is for a luxurious room. Sizes, if you see, 3.5 meters to 5.5 meters and 5 meters by 6 meters and 7 by 9 meters is the general dimensions that are adopted for drawing room or hall. We can call it as a hall also. Next, coming to ventilation in drawing rooms. So minimum window area should not be less than 10% of the floor area, but 20% is preferred so that good lighting will be there in the drawing room and as well as a good ventilation will be there if you provide 20% of the floor area. So this is about the size of the room. Next, coming to dining room. Dining room is the place where families take breakfast, lunch, dinner. So that this also should be required much with a good sizes or good dimensions. 4 by 3 or 4 by 5 or 5 by 6 are the dimensions generally adopted. And then coming to the kitchen. Kitchen is the place where food is going to be prepared and stored for consumption. So here also good lighting facility is required. So good ventilation is required. And dimensions, if you see, 1.5 meter by 3 meter or 3 by 5 or 4 by 6 is generally adopted. Ventilation in kitchen area is at least 15% of floor area we have to provide, then only proper ventilation and proper lighting will be possible. So that is why ventilation is very much essential in kitchen. Next, coming to the bedrooms. So bedrooms are the rooms where people spend major part of the day in the bedroom, either sleeping or relaxing. So in the day, around 12 hours people will be spending, or around 6 hours they will be spending in the bedroom, right? So that is why this is very much important. The minimum floor area is 10 square meters and sizes, if you see, 4 by 3, 5 by 4, 3 by 3 or 4 by 3, 4 by 4. So these are the sizes. And ventilation, minimum window area of 10% of floor area we have to provide so that good lighting will be there and good air circulation will be there into the bedroom. Next one, bathroom and water closet. Bathroom is the place where people take bathing and waste water is collected and conveyed off. The waste water closet is the place of collection of human discharge. So that also will be provided. So the minimum floor area is 1.8 square meters and floor area of bath and water closet should not be less than 2.8 meters and minimum width is 1.2 meters. So water closet should have minimum width of 0.9 meters and minimum length of 1.2 meters. So minimum floor area is 1.1 square meters provided for water closet and for bathing it is another 1.8 square meters. So that is why around 2 to 3 square meters we will be providing for bathing and water closet. Ventilators of 500 mm by 300 mm is provided at a height of 1.8 from the floor and the sizes, if you see, size of the room, bathroom and water closet combined, 1.5 by 2 meters or 2 meter by 3 meter or 3 meter by 4 meter. Then coming to the storeroom. स्टोर रूम इट इज़ टू स्टोर फूड ग्रेन्स सिलेंडर्स एक्सेट्रा एक्सेट्रा वेस्ट मटेरियल सो द फ्लोर एरिया इज 15 स्क्वेयर मीटर्स टू 20 स्क्वेयर मीटर एंड वरांडा कमिंग टू द वरांडा इफ द एरिया ओपन ऑन वन साइड आर टू साइड्स आर थ्री साइड्स इट इज द एरिया ओपन एरिया दट इज गोइंग टू बी प्रोवाइड सो द मिनिमम विड्थ ऑफ वरांडा इज 1.5 मीटर एंड नॉट ग्रेटर दैन 4 मीटर्स एंड मिनिमम हाइट ऑफ वरांडा इज 2.1 मीटर्स सो दैट वे वी हैव टू प्रोवाइड दिस वरांडा ऑल्सो नेक्स्ट कमिंग टू द पूजा रूम Many people prefer puja room in houses. It is quite calm space to perform puja. It should be located in northeast corner of the building. We have to remember that this it should be provided at the northeast corner and sizes will be 2.1 by 2.1 which provide nearly 4 meter square area. Study room. It is a place where people study, place where study material are stocked and read. For reading purpose, if you are providing a room, then it is called study room and the area of study room should be 10 to 12 meter square. So here you can see how it was planned. This is the kitchen, this is the kitchen and this is the main entrance. It is the hall, it is the dining area very close to kitchen. We have to provide close to kitchen we have to provide. Next this is the study room and this is the lounge or hall you can call and this is the bedroom and this is the lounge means it is a TV room or relaxing room. So likewise we can provide here you can see this is a double combined building or semi-detached building we call. So here we see this is the hall area here also this is the hall area attached with the dining and kitchen into the hall. Similarly these two and this one, these three are the bedrooms we are having. So three bedroom hall kitchen along with puja room. Here we have provided puja and these two are the attached toilets we are having here, attached toilets. And here also likewise kitchen, bedroom, this is the bedroom and this is another bedroom, this is attached toilet, here also attached toilet and this is the dining room and this is the living room or hall in which people will be entering this way. And this is the utility or balcony or veranda. They have provided balcony here in the first floor. Here also we have balcony and utility. So all these are different plans you can see here. So this is about building bylaws and minimum dimensions of the building components, what you are adopting, what is required to be adopted, and hope everyone have understood well. Thank you.